नमस्कार एंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू दिस एडिशन ऑफ कोविड लाइव प्रोग्राम लेट्स टॉक वैक्सीन क्वेश्चन आर आई एम निधि कुमार एंड यू आर वाचिंग इंडिया साइंस. वेल इंडिया रिकॉर्डेड अ सिंगल डे राइज ऑफ 10,853 न्यू कोविड 19 केसेस टुडे. द क्यूमुलेटिव डोजेस एडमिनिस्टर्ड इन द कंट्री सो फार अंडर द नेशन वाइड कोविड 19 वैक्सीनेशन ड्राइव हैज एक्सीडेड 107.92 क्रोर्स. इन दिस प्रोग्राम we take your questions from Facebook and YouTube live also. So today we're joined by the very eminent Padma Shri, Dr. Virender Singh Chauhan, eminent scientist and ETI founder. A stunning new discovery in India could in future lead to the development of a new vaccine against malaria, which is now being spoken about. Today we cover this detailed information about the new malaria vaccine with Dr. Chauhan to answer these questions and to talk about the significance of this development. Many thanks for joining us today. Namaste and welcome, Doctor. Thank you so much for coming on India Science.
Thank you.
So my first question to you is, Kerala is again in the eye of the storm. It has been accounting for half of India's caseload. Please tell us about the AY.41.2 variant, sir.
So the world over, the let me just very quickly take a step back. When the virus was multiplying on one side, by early September last year, the first variant of virus started showing up. UK, South Africa, Brazil, which are famously known as Alpha, Beta, Gamma variant. And in February, sometime early this year, the Delta variant, which now by now is the most fast spreading, or one might say deadly variant of virus. So as science has grown, vaccines have grown, vaccination has grown, variants of virus have, and this is natural, this is nothing out of ordinary. But since February, the Delta variant, which has gone all over the world, and the current infections all over the world are majorly driven. Delta has overtaken all other previous viruses. So the earlier virus, Wuhan virus, has almost disappeared. And its variant forms are spreading the virus. But as I speak with you, if you look at the overall situation in the world, including in India, the viral infections and virus spread of pandemic is on decline. It's not an increase. So Kerala, which we used to show 30,000, 20,000, 15,000, is not showing what you might call alarming number. The overall in India, total country, yesterday or day before were only 10,000 cases, roughly about 10,000 cases. Now for the size of Indian population, this is highly successful decline of the virus. So I would worry. Now, some variants of Delta, in fact, in America, there are Kappa, there are Mu in Colombia. So these variants will come. These are small variation, but none of them have become more deadly or more widespreading than Delta. So I don't think there's any major concern variant has shown up post-Delta. So I won't worry too much about the current Kerala virus. The Kerala cases are down to less than 30% of what they were about a month and a half back.
Sir, we have a question on our YouTube, sir. Russia and China have reported a surge with the new coronavirus variant believed to be even more contagious and more transmissible. So please comment on the present state of these two countries.
So I've not followed. If somebody has followed, there's a new variant. So what will happen when you vaccinate? Let's say China first. China has vaccinated more than 2.5 billion people. Not 2 billion people. So almost every, if not everybody, but very large number of people have seen vaccine. When you vaccinate people, and virus still multiplies, so virus is now looking at the antibodies or through vaccine which man has thrown at virus. So I had said it earlier that beyond Delta, there is no serious variant that has come up. If it's come up only yesterday, day before, I'm not aware of. If it is one slightly different form of Delta, it might be so. Saying that Russia cases have gone on, Russia actually have had serious issues of Delta virus about a month back. And Moscow showed very large number of patients. They were hospitalized. But I think I want to tell the viewers, the vaccine uptake of in Russia, although Sputnik V and its variant, one single shot, was discovered in Russia and has been given to 60, 70 more countries. But the uptake of vaccine in Russia is surprisingly low. And I think there can be multiple reasons for this. And so let me summarize this. Are we going to see more variants of this virus? As I said, since February or since January, we haven't seen deadlier forms of Delta. Why is Delta deadly? Let me quickly deal with it, because there are similar viruses, obviously will be there. Delta multiplies much faster. It is a more infectious. So two things happen with Delta. A, it is more infectious. That is, it enters your body much more easily. B, once it enters multiplication, to create its recreation of itself is many, many times faster. So it creates high viral load in the individual, and it's more infectious. That's why contact tracing with Delta has been much more difficult. But let me say this to you. I've been following word over, especially where the vaccination has been very successful. The virus is still there. There is no doubt about it. But the total number of cases, if you see worldwide, they are more on decline rather than on spreading. Will there be small shoots of virus here, there, sometime in Russia, sometime in Indonesia, sometime in Colombia? Very much possible. But we have to keep an eye on the total surge. So after deadly second wave in India, very deadly wave in Indonesia, extremely deadly wave in Malaysia, and then fourth wave in Japan and so on. I think we'll keep hearing this. That's why it's very important to viewers to understand the pandemic is still going on. Its intensity has gone down. So anything that we were doing before, like mask or sarah, we should not relax on this. And watch. My own take is, if we can successfully ward off this winter and get into January, so winter in Europe, winter in India can be warded off with lower number of cases, then you'll see more success in controlling the pandemic. And then it might become an endemic virus sometime in one country. But that happens with many diseases. It happens with flu, happens with cholera, happens with many diseases. So I'm more optimistic than pessimistic.
Right, sir. So last week or a few days back, the World Health Organization approved the world's first vaccine against malaria, RTS-S, known by its brand name Moscovix. Please tell us more about this vaccine and its development, sir, because it's taken about 30 years to develop this, whereas if we compare this with COVID-19 vaccine, we did it in less than, 18 months.
So I'll try to be as less technical as possible so that people will understand. Malaria vaccine scientists have been, including us at ICDP, have been trying to do this for more than 4 decades. This is when the first proteins of the malaria. So malaria and a virus, malaria is a parasite. It's not a viral disease. Parasites have very complicated cycle inside the human. And these are obligatory parasites. So malaria parasite can either live inside a mosquito or inside a host, which is a vertebrate, warm-blooded host. It could be squirrel, it could be monkey, it could be human. There are 5 types of malaria which can infect humans. And it's very interesting that they are very similar, but they are very specific. For example, monkey malaria, which is cynomolgus, does not infect humans. And P. falciparum, which is a deadly form of human malaria, does not infect monkeys or does not infect mice. So malaria research has been very difficult to do because there is no good quality animal model. This is complexity number one. Number two, the cycle of growth, unlike in the case of virus. In case of virus like COVID or flu, virus enters your cell and very quickly multiplies using your own machine. The parasite, in this case of falciparum or vivax, there are five malaria which can infect human, as you said. is falciparum, which is most deadly. Vivax, which is widespread but doesn't kill as much as falciparum does. Then malaria, then ovale, and then very about few years back, nolsai was also seen in humans. But the first two that I mentioned, which is falciparum and vivax, are the serious concern. India sees lot of falciparum as well as vivax. Many countries in Africa sees largely falciparum. So the most deaths that occur happen in sub-Saharan Africa. And unfortunately, the death happens in children, very young children, till the age of five. A very large number of children die between 0 to 2 years. So that's the malaria etiology. Vivax doesn't kill, but it gives you all the symptoms of malaria. All these malaria can be treated by drugs. Initially, it was chloroquine. Then there's resistance. Now there are artemisinin-based drugs, which are very successful. And that's why malaria was controlled. So malaria can be easily detected and easily treated. I say this easily because now, unfortunately, there are places in the world, starting from Cambodia, and now, very recently, only last month, reports from Africa that some strains of P. falciparum, which are going to be resistant to artemisinin also. The future, if this spreads, is going to be a serious issue. Vaccines, therefore, are very important. Why malaria vaccine has been so difficult to make? And let me say a little bit about RTSS. RTSS has been in research and production for past 30, 35 years. Some of the best agencies in the world, NIH agency and very big pharma company, GlaxoSmithKline, GSK. So these were the ones who are pushing this vaccine. Unfortunately for malaria, unlike in COVID, you have to target audiences, very young children. So your vaccination actually has to eventually, a target audience will be very young babies in Africa or India or wherever you want to vaccinate. It won't really be adults, unlike in the case of viral disease. So controlling, you can control mosquito, if you can control mosquito population. And again, I very quickly want to say, it's the only female mosquito of a special kind, Anopheles, is the one which can carry the infection. Male counterpart of mosquito can bite you, take blood out of you, but can't carry the malaria parasite. So it's a very scientifically very specific, exquisite interactions. Once it malaria enters our body, after when the blood meal is taken by a female infected mosquito, while it's sucking the blood, at the same time, some of the malaria parasites are injected in our body. They only go to liver. They go nowhere else. If there's no liver gone, they can't multiply. So first stage of malaria growth is in the liver. It takes 7 to 10 days, depending on which parasite. And by this time, we don't know we have malaria. No idea. There's no way to detect malaria, unlike in case of COVID. Now after the liver stage, malaria comes out and gets into our blood. This is called the blood stage malaria. What has gone into liver is very different than what come out from liver. And I'm saying this to explain why it is difficult to make a vaccine against malaria. So the proteins change. And very quickly, after the blood stage, it goes into something called a sexual cycle. The male and female parasite are produced. And now if an infected female mosquito takes a bite, this parasite enters her body, and then the whole cycle begins again. So this is how malaria spread. Malaria expresses about 5,000 genes. COVID would have less than, they have some 20 genes maximum. All viruses have very small number of genes. For example, in the case of COVID, we knew very, very quickly earlier on that we have S protein against which we have to make antibodies. In malaria, there are so many proteins, we just don't know which one is going to be. That's why taking so long. Anyway, so you can have a liver stage vaccine, you can have a blood stage vaccine, you can have something called transmission blocking. All three will be different from each other, all could be useful. My lab works on bloodstain vaccine. But RTSS is a vaccine which is a liver stain vaccine. So there's a protein on the liver stain parasite called sporozoite. This protein is expressed on a very large amount. The basis for vaccine in case of malaria is very similar to the basis for the COVID vaccine. That find the right protein, inject into humans, raise antibodies, like in case of COVID, which should neutralize the virus cover. So the RTSS took long time. The RTR and T comes from malaria. S comes from a backbone of this vaccine is a hepatitis surface protein. And this, I'm not going to be technical on this. It's a complex mixture which has hepatitis portion as well as malaria. Unfortunately, malaria portions are not very large on this. But nonetheless, this vaccine went into the older people, then younger people, then finally in children, supported by WHO. The large trials were done in Malawi, Ghana, and so on and so forth. The vaccine protects to about 40-50% in the initial stages. It needs four boosters, four shots in young children. But the immunity wanes off after 3-4 years. And so you see no difference between vaccinated versus unvaccinated people. Now the question is it a successful good vaccine or not? And if not, why WHO has approved it? So first of all, it's a landmark because malaria vaccine took so long to come to stage where we are. Then it does protect 40-50% in the first year where large number of lives are saved. It will require four shots. Giving one shot is difficult in Africa. Giving four shots will not be easy. Then the question will be who will fund for vaccine, because this vaccine will be given in the places where people are the most poor people in the world. So these questions will come up. But I still celebrate the announcement that this vaccine has been produced finally with great labor. Then the question viewer can ask, if it is only 40% successful, then why bother? Why not discover better vaccine? The answer to that is yes. Everybody wants to discover better vaccine for tuberculosis, for malaria, for HIV, and that research is going on. So there is a vaccine which is produced by a group from Oxford based on the same rationale as RTSS, but a different design. It's called R21. That vaccine has also undergone phase 1, phase 2, and now undergoing phase 3 trial. Efficacy of that vaccine seems so far much higher than the vaccine RTSS. So if that kind of vaccine comes, that vaccine shows efficacy of 77%. WHO landmark successful rate was 75%. But in malaria, even if you protect 50%, you are saving large number of lives. So this discussion can go on how successful the vaccine would be. I'll finish this RTSS. Will it have any impact in a country like India? Well, the question is that you have to give four doses to very young children and you have to be able to afford this vaccine. It'll be produced by GSK. So the financial burden of this vaccine will become very important. And now there are methods by which you want to protect people from malaria, like you use bed nets, you use medicine, you detect early. And I think all these efforts should go on. Should there be better vaccine than the current RTS? Answer is yes. Is there any chance of getting better vaccine now since we've seen success of RTSS? I think everybody is very excited, and especially after WHO approval. So my own view is, although there's not very large sums of money in malaria vaccine development, but scientists have not given up, and I hope there will be better vaccine than the current RTSS.
Absolutely, sir.
If I have not covered any part of RTSS.
Yes. The other question that I would like to ask you now is that you've been researching on malaria for such a long time. We are celebrating this vaccine. Absolutely, yes. And we look forward to it being administered in India also. Could you tell us how it will be administered? Will it be the same way like the COVID-19 vaccines, Covaxin or Covishield? Or is the procedure going to be slightly different? And also, with your study, the efficacy is 40%. Could it get better with the same RTSS? What are your thoughts?
No, so RTSS can't get better than what it is. It has yet to be tested in India. So if Indian health system brings this vaccine here, I only want to say that you'll need 4 shots into very young children. That will be a task to do. In the highly endemic areas in India, such as in Orissa, it might be useful to test this vaccine. But once again, the question of accessing this vaccine will become important. It will have to go through DCGI, same process as everything is gone. I would really eye better vaccine than RTSS. And if R21, which incidentally, the research version of it was produced in India by Serum Institute. So India is very much involved in malaria vaccine production. Our own research and many other groups in India, and especially our group at ICG, we're working on a blood stage vaccine. It just takes long time to get to formulation, then safety issues. You have to first check safety in animals, then have to see whether you produce that stuff which can go into human. So we've done 2 phase 1 trials, and our Vivex vaccine produced by Dr. Chetan Chitnis group at ICGB and my own group in collaboration is beginning to look extremely good. That vaccine is undergoing a trial in Oxford right now as I speak with you. So I can't say more than that, but I think Indian malaria vaccine research is well alive, and some younger people have come back to India, and the Department of Biotechnology is funding malaria. In fact, India is the best place to do quality vaccine research for any disease, because the production, you know, the production of the even test vaccine becomes a major issue. And India is very well placed because of the pharma company which produced very high quality. So I think what we need is coordination from government departments, from scientists. Scientists should not lose enthusiasm for tough diseases like TB, malaria, and HIV. But I really think, I hope younger people will listen to this, that India should be the best place to do vaccine research, whether it is Nipah virus or malaria or whatever. So I'm very hopeful.
Another question that I'd like to ask on behalf of viewers is long COVID, and we're seeing a lot of lung cases coming up, and a lot of people complaining of giddiness as well. And the lung MRI is also showing a lot of concern. So how would you like to talk about long COVID, and what is your current research telling you, sir?
So what we know about COVID, that it 80% of people of us who get, or 85%, remain asymptomatic. So as far as virus is concerned, if it infects 100 people, a large number of us don't even know we have the virus. In other words, our body fights this virus pretty successfully. Now, of the left, those who get the disease, they some get moderate symptoms, they get fever for a day or two, or the bad throat, then they clear. Unfortunately, a certain percentage, very small, gets severe disease. What we know about COVID-19 and do not know about COVID is this, that a lot of people who did get exposure to or get infected have come back and complain of tiredness, of not being able to do what they were doing before as efficiently. That number is as much as 10 to 15%. Not everybody will have long COVID. Most of us will recover. But 10%, 15% is a very large number at a number of people who get infected. They have complained also. And we know scientifically that this, because ACE2 receptor, which is the virus home, in the sense virus attaches itself to ACE2 receptor, is on many other organs. Of course, because of air, the lung, it goes to the airway first, because that's where you breathe virus from. We know that virus can enter even the brain of a person. I think these things, mechanisms are known. What is unknown is what will be the eventual outcome of long COVID. Will it remain for a year, for two? Will you get better? So it'll be risky to answer that question. But we know that people have complained about, which you don't do for flu, by the way. Flu comes in bad nose, red eyes, and flu goes away. At least that way we feel. You get one viral infection, you get out of the 10-15, you get malaria, you get treated with artemisinin chloroquine, and then malaria goes away, and so on. But in this fellow, so I think more research will need to be done. What is documented, yes, the last 10% or 11% people have shown symptoms that they get very tired. They just can't work, they can't bend. Sometimes they have haziness in the brain also. So they're beginning not to remember, they're struggling. What are the scientific basis of this need to be figured out? And I can assure the viewer, these are serious concern among the scientists, immunologists or cell biologists. But we know that ACE receptors are on many cells. So it's not surprising that other organs are also being affected. In that sense, it's a bad virus, not a friendly virus. But it's too early to say exactly how long, who will get, is there a predisposition? Some people are likely to get long COVID more than others. I think all these studies will need to be done.
Sir, another question, and this is a general question. Sir, what does this pollution mean for those who could probably get COVID-19 now? We're absolutely living in a gas chamber if we talk of Delhi. So one of our viewers has asked, what is, as a doctor, your take on the effect on lungs?
So I am a research scientist. I'm not a doctor. I'm a pseudo doctor. But what will happen is this. If you get COVID and you recover or you in COVID, so your immune system is fighting a virus which has come. And in that sense, you are compromised. You feel tired. Your system is busy fighting. In that, if you add pollution, then I think your recovery rate or your respiratory system will be under so much more stress. Personally, I don't think environmental, the pollution with somebody who doesn't have COVID versus somebody who has COVID are going to be any great different. If there's another virus so we are not talking, we just talk of pollution, suspended particles in the atmosphere or the gases. I think whether you have had COVID or recovered from COVID or currently having COVID would not scientifically make great difference between this or that. However, if you are weakened by exposure to COVID and your system is fighting, you're still recovering, then your power of fighting what you get from the environment will be compromised. And of course, then you might take longer. So those will be effects. But per se, suspended particle, I don't think there's any great connection.
All right, sir. My last question to you, sir, is boosters are becoming the norms in Europe and US. What about India? When can we expect to get our first boosters?
I'm glad you asked that question because there's a lot of fuzziness about it. Do we need booster at all? There's a moral ethical issue by saying that most of Africa is unvaccinated. Is it good to consider third dose for some when many in the world haven't had even their first dose? So these moral ethical problems aside, what does the science say? So as of now, and a lot of people on television have said T-cell immunity, B-cell immunity, but as of now, the only correlate to protection is the level of antibodies and on that neutralizing antibody to the virus. If the neutralizing antibodies levels have gone down after 6 months or 8 months, especially those who are susceptible, people who have diabetes, people who are obese, people who have other immunocompromised position, you would successfully argue that their antibody levels have gone down. So they can't fight the infection. So we need to give them booster. Now, should you do it at a population level? But depends where you are. If your whole country is vaccinated with two shots or very, and you still have vaccines to spare, I suppose you can make a case for giving health workers, those who are going to be, and if your pandemic is still going on, if there's still virus, then you could argue for immunocompromised people and so on. My own take would be it will be very demographic and locational answer. In India, we still are vaccinating. A lot of people haven't got their first dose. So policy, as a policymaker, I think our first priority would be to vaccinate as many people as possible. If there is possibility, then those who are highly susceptible to, one can consider third dose. But if I were to be a decision maker, I'll vaccinate as many people as possible first, then move to booster dose.
And on that note, doctor, I'd like to thank you, Dr. Virender Singh Chauhan, for joining us on this special malaria broadcast on COVID queries. And with this, this is a wrap of this edition of Question Hour. Until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy. On that note, namaskar, keep watching India Science.